Hi, this is Anthony from MakeWeirdMusic.com, and I'm here with Morgan Agren, who has joined us all the way from Sweden. Morgan, thank you very much for joining us. So let's just get started. The purpose of the site is to get people to learn about new musicians and new kinds of music. So could you introduce yourself and tell us about your musical history and why people might know who you are as a musician?
Yeah, and thanks for calling me, by the way. I'm happy to be here. And I think I heard about your site or your activities quite recently, actually. And that and then I found an email from you in this weird hidden folder in the Facebook Messenger thing. And as you might know, if you're not friends with the people that you get message from, it gets in a hidden folder. Sometimes I check this folder because who knows, you know, and then I found you there just a few weeks after I heard some snippets from an interview that you did with Anthony Levin.
Marcus Reuter.
Ben Levin, I mean. Ben Levin.
Oh, Ben Levin, yes.
Anthony is your name. Ben Levin from Bent Knee.
Yes. Yeah,
I think that was the interview I saw and where I noticed your Make Weird Music thing. So yeah. Awesome. My name is Morgan Ågren. I'm a drummer, musician, composer, living in Stockholm, a little bit outside Stockholm in Sweden. I just turned 49 and not 50 yet, but I'm getting there. And I started to play at age 4 or 5 something, I think, drums, and met my musical partner at age 14, when I was 14 and he was 10. I met Mats Öberg, which is my lifelong musical partner, and that's where it started for me. I think before that I had my father was in a Swedish so-called dance band, and they were my first idols, so that's where it really started, because they were a big influence on me. And all of my when I went to school, you get a pen and paper and you write whatever you want, and I wrote a lot about them, you know, his band, about their tour bus and everything. So this is like hundreds of pages about my dad's band. So obviously they were my first idols. And my first time on stage was with them when they had me to come up on stage and play. And then I was 7, so that was my premiere. So that's where it kind of started. And I started a record company in 96. I released some 15-20 albums or something, and then I moved on to a label called Cuneiform, because it was too much work that didn't have too much to do with music, but you know, paperwork and all that stuff, you know. It was a good period still, because it was a good experience to make your own albums and release them and trying to get them out, you know. And I released my own albums on this label, but I also released like projects with other friends, and you know, like my brother and Fredrik from Meshuga, he did his solo album, which is probably the album that when it comes to releases, that's probably the one that's most famous. His album Soul Niger Within, I released that in 97, I think, and I did some projects with Danny Wally and former guitarist from Frank Zappa and Tom Waits. And then I play with Frank, of course. Some people knows me from that fact. I played with Frank Zappa when I was 20, and first time, and then he invited me to the US later on, a few years before he passed away. And I was used to be a member of a Swedish group called Flesh Quartet, and I mean, that's a little bit of my background, yeah.
I found out about you through Zappa's Universe. I bought the VHS copy of the concert, and I said, who's the keyboard player and who's that drummer? Because you guys were not part of the standard Zappa touring band. And then I found out about Mats Morgan and just unbelievable music. So can you tell us about, I mean, you mentioned a musical partner, and in the interviews that I've done so far on the site, nobody's really mentioned a musical partner, and you guys have been making music since you were kids together. So can you tell us about how that started and where it's gone, and what's special about Mats that makes you guys so close musically?
Yeah, I mean, and the thing is that in November this year, we're actually going to have our 35 years anniversary. It's 35.
Congratulations.
So it's kind of unreal how much time we actually have together, you know. So I see it as truly as a gift, you know, because it's hard to know. I remember when I met Mats, I was 14 and he was 10, and I knew already by then that this is such a nice meeting, you know. I could tell from the first moment that this is, wow, I mean, this can really be good, and this is already good, you know, and stuff like that. But now, 35 years later, you can look at what happened from another perspective, you know, because now I'm, at that time, I was happy about it, of course, and I was excited and everything. But now, 35 years later, I think you look at these years as more like in a more humble way, or maybe in a thankful way or something. I don't know, because meetings like this doesn't really happen often, and I put a more, even more value on the fact that I met him now than when we, at the time when we played, I guess, you know, because so and how that happened was that I received a phone call from a lady in my hometown, and she actually, I can, this is coincidence, but I can actually try to, this, can you see this?
Yeah, there we go. That's better, yeah, at that's the better angle.
Yeah, the woman there in the middle, that's, this picture is taken, I think, 2002 maybe, and this lady is actually the lady who called me that day in 81. So she called me, somebody called me, this girl called me, and she asked me, you know, hello, my name is blah blah blah, and I'm running a little music cafe outside Umeå, outside me and Matt's hometown, and I'm gonna have this guy called named Mats Öberg who plays piano. He's gonna play some 15-20 minutes there, and I read about you in a magazine, and in the local magazine, and I just had a sense that you and him would fit together. That's what she told me, and I, at this moment I didn't know anything about Mats. The only thing I knew was that I heard, while being on vacation with my family once, we were listening to the radio, and there was a guy that was super young that talked in the radio and played fantastic music, you know, it's music that never gets played in the radio, and a guy probably at the time maybe 9 played music on the radio. That I heard on the radio, so I started to realize that maybe I heard this guy on the radio once, but other than that, I didn't know anything about him. But I got the request to come out to this place and to play drums with him, and so I did. I was happy to get this request. I went there, and we met like probably 2 hours before the concert, and we were supposed to play 15-20 minutes, and so we met on the venue, shook hands, and you know, and he looked like maybe like he looked like he was 7 or 8, even though he was 10. He looked really tiny, and so we started to discuss, so what can we possibly play, because we it has to be covers now, because we just met and we're going to be on stage in 2 hours. So he started to ask me, do you know this and this and this band, you know? And so he asked me, do you know Beatles? And the only song I knew by them at the time that I could possibly play without rehearsal was Help. So I said, okay, I know Help. And of course, whatever I said, he knew it, you know? That was the crazy thing, you know? Do you know it? Yes, I know it. Okay, do you know Stevie Wonder? He continues, and then for some reason, I had a friend whose older brother just bought Hotter Than July, and every time I was at his house, he played that album. So I remember the first track, Master Blaster.
Uh-huh.
And I told Mats, I know this song, this reggae type of song, Master Blaster, maybe. And do you know it? Yeah, I know it, he said. So. Okay, so now we have 2 songs. We need at least one more. And then he asked me, do you know Frank Zappa? And of course, Bobby Brown was the only one I knew. And he knew that one too, of course. So then we had 3 songs and we had a short little sound check. And then we went on stage and just played. And super tiny little house, like a cabin with, I would say, like 10, 15 people in the audience. And the room would take maybe 30 people, and that would be full, you know, packed. And I remember almost, I mean, I really remember clearly that I was totally amazed by the fact that I was doing a concert, but at the same time I was in the audience, because I was also watching him play in disbelief, you know. He was standing up with his electric grand. And he played the electric grand was, you know, almost close to his chin, and then
yeah.
And then he played incredibly, and he sang in almost perfect. The language was good, and his mother didn't let him sing the ugly words in Bobby Brown, so so he left those out. But other than that, he was singing and playing in an incredible way. And I remember also after the concert, because both our parents were there, my dad and his dad was there, because they were driving us with our car, you know, to the venue. And after we met backstage, and both our parents was really touched from having seen their kids do that together, you know, with 2 hours of, you know, just meet, nothing, almost no preparation at all, you know. And and I think my dad was, I could see, and he was almost crying because what he saw. And Matt's father was also really like, he started to go on me and say, like, maybe you could do again, you know, we have drums in the basement, and maybe blah 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 blah. He really wanted, you know, he saw a possibility that Mats found a friend that liked the same music as he did. So that was basically how we met. And and this photograph that I showed you, this was like, this happened like 2002. And then this lady called me up again, and I haven't spoken with her since 81, but she called me and asked me, is this drummer Morgan Agren? So, yeah, it's me. my name is, and I live here and there, and you know, as I guess you remember, the first time you play with Mats in this cafe, she goes, and the girl who called you there, that was me, she said. And I got like the chills, you know, almost, because I was wondering so many times, who was this lady that called me from the blue, you know, and having this idea of me and Mats getting together. So next time we went to Umeå, our hometown, we set up a meeting with her, and we just, you know, went over to her house to say hello and have a cup of coffee and, you know, and take some photos.
So that's wonderful.
Yeah, so that's the very first time, and this was in November 81. And I mean, after that, me and Mats, we met, if not on a weekly basis, which was the most case, we met on a weekly basis. Sometimes maybe it went 2 or 3 weeks, I don't know, but it was quite, you know, regularly. And for the next 35 years, more or less, I mean, I have never been out of contact with Mats more than a few weeks all the way since then, you know. We have been doing a lot of other things. I mean, we play all the time, but sometimes, I mean, both of us plays with other acts, and so this is not the only thing we do, but we have played all the way since then, you know, and we tour all over the world and play with a lot of our teenage idols and whatever, you know. So it was a really good meeting and a really good, you know, I'm really happy for that, of course.
So one thing you didn't mention is that he's blind.
Yes, he's blind, and that was partly, I mean, I would have been equally amazed about what he did when we did this first gig, but the fact that he was blind, that he is blind, is makes everything even more amazing. He's born blind, and I think that a guy like him that is born with a thing like this, the focus in life gets only, I mean, his things in life is music and food. I mean, that's what he enjoys, you know, so he doesn't care about too much other things maybe, and that's how we developed this ability, I think. And this happened very early, long time before I met him, because I know for sure that he was listening to, I mean, when he was like 2 or 3 years old, he was listening to the typical lullaby music as all the other kids at the same time as he was listening to Mahavishnu Orchestra, because that he actually did when he was 3 or 4 years. So a little bit Miles, a little bit Mahavishnu, and then some lullabies, and then, you know, he went back and forth between really different music and the diaper music, if I say so. Yeah,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, and I know some stories from his childhood that he was really, you know, because I think his parents gave him some kind of downer, you know, he had to eat something that put his energy down, because he was listening to music for, I think, maybe 10 hours straight without any breaks, without any break, you know, and... he got hyper, you know, and he was scratching vinyls, listening to the vinyls backwards. Everything was just sound. And I know that, for instance, when he was 7, I think, he sort of forced his parents to buy the latest Earth, Wind and Fire album. Otherwise, he had like a stair at home, so he went to the end of the stairs, and he standing on the edge there, and he said to his parents, if you don't buy the last album, I will jump, and stuff like that, because he was really, I really want the last Earth, Wind and Fire, get it for me, otherwise I jump, stuff like that, you know, really like.
Wow, that's astonishing. Did you guys study together musically? Like, did you study music or any formal music education, or is everything you do just through self-learning?
I would say self-learning, although we went to high school. We went to the same high school, actually, in Stockholm, but we started so early, and for me, everything I do comes from me listening to albums and just listening and being inspired, and I got so much inspiration from listening to all these albums at an early age, so... Everything was on these albums. I didn't really had any questions, because everything was there, and the only problem was to do it yourself. And I mean, that's something you have to develop, of course, but I think that as soon as you hear something, and as soon as you really feel that this is really what I like, this is really what I want to do, I don't want to do that, but I want to do this, and as soon as you know and feel that, in a way, I think you're halfway, you know, because then that's, it's about personality and in the music and the whole spirit and everything, because the music is like a mirror of yourself, I would say. So when you get this inspiration, you you realize that, I mean, for instance, when I heard a few of those albums that really opened up a new universe for me, I think was an album called Road Games by Alan Holdsworth. All these chords and the harmonies and everything, besides him of course being a fantastic guitarist, but the music, the compositions took me just somewhere else where I wanted to be, you know. This was just, I'm home, you know, this is really what I like. And if I haven't run into an album like that at age 14, maybe I was 14, 15, I don't know what, you know, all that album and many others, of course, but those albums, all those albums was really important for me, in not only as a musician playing drums, trying to compose, but also as an individual in a spiritual way, you know. It was really important. And then another album that I was listening to on and on was Returned Forever, Romantic Warrior. These two albums, and the first album by UK, Bill Bruford, One of a Kind, Breaker Brothers, Heavy Metal Bebop, there are many, but those albums just kept going on and on and on and on and on. And then, you know, you, when you have that, going to school, I mean, I know that I started so early, so I'm aware of the fact that it was quite easy for me to play because I started early. I don't say that a school would be useless or anything like that, but for me, the inspiration and the energy I got from the album was more worth than any drum book in the world or any school, you know. The schools were good too, because I met nice people. I even have some good teachers that inspired me. And Mats, we don't read music. I'm a lousy reader, and Mats, obviously he's blind, so he doesn't read. But we just listen and learn from that, I can say.
And how would you describe the music you two make?
I think that, you know, the typical way to describe our music, when sitting like you're sitting in a taxi and you have a few minutes ride with a stranger, and you know he's not into music at all, and he asks you, the short version that would be for someone like him, I say that it's a mix between jazz and rock, jazz music and rock music, and usually nobody sings. That's like the short version. And if I feel that the taxi driver is interested in talking about this, I can, and if I can feel that he knows some groups and stuff, maybe I say that, okay, take Beatles and mix Beatles with Frank Zappa and add some jazz and rock and blah blah blah. And then they get a little bit more, maybe like an idea of what it's about. But and me telling you, it's really hard, because I know you interviewed many people and you know a lot about music, I'm sure. So it's really hard, because I don't know. It's really hard. I just know. I mean, what can also be added to this thing that I used to say to the taxi driver type of guy is that it's quite loud because it's electrified bass and guitar, and it's like more like rock music, even though it's not like, it's not Bruce Springsteen, of course, even though he plays rock music, but this rock music we play is not at all like that. And but it's really hard, you know, to describe, I think.
Yeah, I agree. That's why I'm asking. It's like music without boundaries to me. I have over here, I've got the Teenage Tapes on air with guests, and then this one with the sewing machine on it. I never remember the titles. Radio Dada. The first song on that album is unbelievable. I just love that. Also have Zappa's Universe here, but yeah, the first song on Radio Dada, oh my goodness, I've listened to that 100 times.
I did a reissue on that album, so I can you tell
I
me
think that's what I have. I supported the Carole King documentary. Yeah. Carl and I have been friends for many years. Oh, yeah. So
but which the first song is it? Här kommer båd.
Yep.
Okay. Okay, it's good that you mentioned that, because I'm putting together, because of the 35 years anniversary in November, I'm putting together a double CD, and I will fill every minute of it, so it will be 2 times 78 minutes or something, and there is just, my last decision will be removing one song to another one, and I'm not really sure, but actually I think we don't have almost anything from that album. So maybe I should, just because you say it now, maybe I should take it on the collection.
It's so melodic, it's so beautiful, and it's so interesting. It's kind of diatonic, normal music sounding, and then there's just these odd notes and things go in different directions. I love it. Yeah. I just think it's beautiful.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, I will consider it to take it on the collection then.
Excellent.
The thing is also that I noticed that your site Make Weird Music, the title of the site is one thing that I think about when I read Make Weird Music. I think that for sure whatever me and Mats did when we composed way back or now, we never tried, you know, or decided to let's try to be weird and stuff like that, you know. It's other people that think it's weird, you know. and we did music, we grew up listening to King Crimson, Magma, Universe Zero, Arch Zoid, Miles Davis, Captain Beefheart, Frank Zappa. And because of that, that's music to me, you know. And I think that, for instance, like somebody like... she was here just 2 days ago. I'm getting a blackout. Beyoncé.
Oh yeah.
She was here 2 days ago, and I think she has some of her songs are great, super great. You know, I love some of the stuff that she's doing. I don't have any albums. I never bought any albums, but I think she's a fantastic vocalist. She's a great artist on stage, and some of the songs are great, you know. And I don't think that at the same time as I like that, I also like Trout Mask Replica by Captain Beefheart, and it's just, it's good for different purposes. They want different things when they do that, you know. And I think that they exist. I love AC/DC even, you know. I went to see AC/DC live 5 times, because mainly because of my brother, who was a big fan when we grew up. So he turned me into that, and I turned him into Frank, and we got a nice mixture there, you know. And but I can tell you, when I went with him to see AC/DC, to see Malcolm Young with his tiny legs, with his Gretsch guitar playing those riffs, I think it's fantastic. It's magic. I think
absolutely.
I think that many of their songs is also timeless, you know. And I mean, not only stuff like when they start Back in Black, I get goosebumps. I think it's fantastic. And they managed to create this thing that when at the moment when being on the concert, I can feel like, why is anyone, I mean, we don't really need anything else than this. This is, why even try to do anything else than this? Because it's so much, I don't know, it's pure and it's for real. And I mean, that's a feeling that I can have when I'm at the concert. And 2 days later, maybe that feeling has faded out a little bit, but still, I mean, there is so much different music that's good, and but again, we never tried. We just tried to do music, you know, and whatever it's called, weird or not, you know. Yeah. So I'm just gonna. I see this phone is losing. So now. It has losing battery, but now it's
battery.
Yeah, I have a cable now. So yeah, but usually I.
Yeah, you know, the weird aspect is much more about like, be yourself. You know, don't try to be somebody else. Yeah. AC/DC does what they do because they're AC/DC.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But don't go out there and try to be AC/DC.
No, exactly.
Be yourself. And that's weird. You're being yourself. You're being a unique and creative individual.
Yeah. And I think that as long as you... I think that many of those... All of those groups I mentioned for you now as influential examples, they were their own. They... It was a true thing, you know. And sometimes when you decide, now I'm going to try to be like this or that, that can be, that's risky, I think. The more true to yourself you are, the better, I think, the result will be at the end.
So you have a very out-of-the-box approach to drumming. I just shared a video of you on Facebook that Carl shared, of you just drumming on sinks and pots and buildings while you're at some campsite.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, yeah.
And you use in his documentary, you use that little trap kit, the pig.
Yeah.
What was it called?
Gig pig.
The gig pig. Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you play a traditional kit. You play tons of polyrhythmic music. You play straightforward stuff. Can you tell us about your approach to music and when you employ these techniques? You know, obviously it's just coming out of you. So
yeah, again, I would say that many of those albums were really important. I remember that when it's about just playing abilities and technique, I would say that the first drummer I was listening to was Buddy Rich. Mm. And I heard him when I was 10 years old. I remember very clearly because he was a guest there was a Frank Sinatra concert in Swedish television, and suddenly he introduced this guy. Big applause to my friend, my old friend Buddy Rich. And then he came in and played some stuff from West Side Story with his drum solo. And it was a shock. I was just... incredibly, you know, and then for the next 5-6 years non-stop I tried to imitate his playing style, and that gave me the fundamentals, I think, the technique, I think, you know, without even realizing it, because all I wanted was to sound like him. So, and while trying to imitate that, I developed playing abilities without not realizing it, I think. So that was a pretty good start, because being 10 years old and imitating that wasn't the easiest thing, you know. And I think that was what realized me then, and even now if I listen to him, because I mean, if you go on YouTube today, you can see anything, you know. Everyone is younger than the other, and everyone is faster than the other, and everyone is it's almost like a dead end at finally, because it's everything is so much the same. I think everything, most things on YouTube has to be amazing rather than good even. It's I don't know. I mean, it can be amazing and good at the same time, but I think that it's too much circus to me, you know. Buddy Rich had an amazing technique, but I think he had a touch that nobody had, you know. It sounded so smooth, you know, because today there is drummers, maybe he plays the speed with one hand that he did, I don't know. It's just, but it's not really important or interesting. I think that he had a sound and a touch that was outstanding for me, and imitating not only the speed or the technical abilities that he had, but trying to get that sound that he got from the drums was something else, you know. That was really a good exercise for the number of years I tried to imitate that, you know. But then other stuff that influenced me and made me who I am today is all of those albums that I already mentioned. But as a drummer, I would say that, because it wasn't only drumming, I mean, in the beginning it was, because when I bought my Buddy Rich albums at age 10, I went with a pickup like this. If it wasn't a drum solo, I didn't listen, you know. I was, where's the drums? Where's the drums? So if I bought an album and there was no drum solo, I got really disappointed and I never listened to the album, you know. So, but when I, as I mentioned before, when I heard Road Games by Alan Holsworth the first time, I mean, all of the guys at the album plays super, of course. Jeff Berlin plays great bass, Chad plays great drums, and Alan plays his guitar, of course. But more important for me was the compositions. I was just like, how can somebody compose this kind of music? It's much more inspiring than any, you know. I mean, this music had both the playing, but also the music. But I think that somewhere later, I don't know when, but at some point I really started to feel that I feel much less interested in the playing, the techniques and the abilities there than the music. Mm-hmm. I want to do music. I don't care who plays what. I just want to make cool music, you know. So that happened to me. I don't know when, but then since you mentioned that the clip when I play on in this farm, or in the gig pig, on the gig pig, I think that one mind opening thing for me was because when I listened to Frank Zappa's recordings in the beginning, I had a lot of bootlegs of him, and I really enjoyed those sections where those sections weren't always on the albums, but there is some of those stuff on Shut Up and Play Your Guitar where Vinny is playing. It's kind of slow tempo and the pulse is there somewhere. It's really there, but it's kind of it's not really like that. And I love the way he played back then, because it was a very like a painter, you know. It was colors and it fit so very well with Frank's guitar, I think. And I had some drum solos. There was one I particularly remember, one concert from a city called Poughkeepsie, I think, and the bootleg, the name of the bootleg was Circus something, I can't remember. But then they play a song called Little House I Used to Live In, and after Tommy Marr's solo, I think it was, there is Vinny's solo, and I think that was the first time I heard a 5 minute, probably about 5 minutes drum solo, where it's free, you know, it's not necessarily pulse, but the pulse is there somehow. Like when Elvin Jones plays, when he played, you can feel it was moving forward in a sort of pulse, even though it wasn't like this. And that was really inspiring for me, because I think it sounded musically very good in a musical way, and so that was a big inspiration for me. And also, I particularly remember one album that I used to mention as one example of maybe the farthest out different albums by a drummer called Ronald Shannon Jackson. He used to play drums with Ornette Coleman, and he had his own band called Decoding Society with Vernon Reed and stuff like that. He made an album called Pulse, which is only drums, and he had a headset microphone, and he read Shakespeare words, and he improvised drums, you know. And Bill Aswell, I think he produced and released this album. I mean, it's super. I mean, it's not Billboard directly. I mean, it's a super small world. But somehow I ran into this album, and this was, wow. I mean, and I think I heard this album in 84, 85, and this was at the same time as Chick Corea came with his electric band, which was really super straight, LA polished, slick fusion stuff, which is nothing wrong with that. But I was never very much into that, though. But when I heard this album Pulse with Ronald Shannon Jackson, and when I discussed music with my friends, I used to say, but hey, listen, you have to listen. Okay, you have that, this polished stuff here, and this, you know, this, whatever you call it. But how about this? And then I played Ronald Shannon Jackson, and it was the total opposite, you know. And that was also so refreshing, because everyone was talking about this, you know, this polished type of music that electric band was playing, and I got sick of it, you know. And I sort of wanted to people to hear something else also. And another guy that really was one of my, at the time, top three drummer influences was actually Gary Husband, who played with Alan Holdsworth. Mm-hmm. There is an album called I O U, and they have some stuff in common, I think, Gary Husband, and even though he's much more time than Ronald Shannon Jackson, because when Ronald plays, sometimes it really sounds like, some moments it sounds like he can't play even, you know. It's so out, you know, and it's so shaky. Mm-hmm. But he has a fantastic sound, and his approach and the wildness, it's something that really talks to me, you know. And but also Gary Husband, he has the same thing. He played on that album, IOU. I think it's also top three albums, you know. It's so spontaneous, and whatever happens in his drumming, it's nothing that he prepared. I can tell that thing that he did, whatever he did that, whatever he did at that part in this song, he never did that before. It just happened, and it wasn't perfect on a technical sense or whatever, but it's perfect for music, because it underlines the music, it helps the music, because Alan goes where he goes, and then the drums comes along, and it's just, these things is not something you necessarily can prepare or rehearse. You sit in the rehearsal place and you exercise a specific thing, and then a few months later you record an album, and then you just do that stuff somewhere, you know, so you can sort of execute it, you know. I think to me, it sounded so much more as an impulse, you know. And also, Gary had a little bit of that Shannon as for the, because it's rough, you know. He misses the drum sometimes. He hits the sticks together, and it sounds, it's not polished. It's wild, you know. In the same way as Tony Williams had, which is another huge. This guy.
this album
just, you know, there is a lot of albums here. This one just, I don't know, I found it on shelf here somewhere, and I put it down. This is just a compilation of some jazz uh-huh. albums. But Tony has that same thing. It sounds like it's falling apart sometimes. It's but at the same time, I also love Steve Jordan and even Jeff Porcaro, where they, because they play in another music world, so where when they play, when Steve Jordan plays with Donald Fagen, I don't want him to sound like Ronald Shannon Jackson, because that's gonna destroy the album, so as long as you do the right thing for what the music wants from you, it's good, so all those drummers influenced me a lot, and I don't know, maybe that has something to do with if I play on the farm, I don't know what it comes from. This was a vacation, we were on vacation, and there was all those cans and stuff, and I happened to have my sticks there, and I started to play, and some of the other guests there were filming me, and that was a spontaneous thing,
So you have a collection of 35 years of musical history. Do you have recordings? I mean, I know you have recordings from when you were young, as teenagers. What do you think about the evolution of your approach to music and drums, composition? When you listen back now, a 49-year-old man, to the 18 or 20 or 24-year-old Morgan Agren, or the 30-year-old Morgan Agren?
Yeah, I mean, it's... I think what's for sure is that the older I get, the this is hard, because sometimes I can miss the old days when you get... everything is even more direct and spontaneous than now. But at the same time, I think that the more it's almost like a wine, a bottle of wine, the older it gets, the more it gets the right shape and form, and I think that I can say like this, I'm super happy that I did what I did when I was 20, and I don't want to do that now, but it was good then and I'm happy for it, and that made me want to do something else later. And now I'm doing something else later than in the beginning, which is normal for me. And but if I should explain in musical terms, I think that the older I get, the more groove based I get. So I can a lot of the music that I'm doing now has less parts and less crazy stuff, maybe the stuff that other people calls crazy. But but even in my mind, I think it's more like I remove all the stuff that doesn't have to be there, even in my mind, so I think it has turned more minimalistic and more groove based, I think.
Soul Niger Within is a very iconic piece of music. It features you doing a lot of amazing technique, a lot of playing with time, and I'm sure it's that young virtuosity that attracted people and to this kind of new form of just riff-based music. I know you recently did a video where you replayed it, and how would you approach a piece of music like that now? Like, what are your thoughts on how you approached it then, and what would you do now to something like that?
Well, this specific music, I think I would have the same approach, more or less, because it's... I think I would do the same thing. The ideas that I get when I hear the music is fairly much the same, I think, today. Because the composition is still the same. If me and Fredrik would do something today, then we would maybe do something else. But as long as I play along to the same old track, I hear more or less the same things as I did back then, I would say, yeah.
Is there more work in the future with the two of you?
Actually, five years ago, I went to his studio and I recorded, I think, at least 4 hours of improvised drums. No click track, no composed material at all. Just random playing by me. But when I did that, of course, I mean, I was thinking that, okay, what can I possibly do that he can make music of after? You know, I had to imagine that while playing, of course, which I did. So I played stuff that I figure will suit his style, and that will make it possible for him to go with the guitar. Because actually, there is one part on the Soul Niger album was made exactly that way too. I can't remember the name. Maybe there is a title called Bounceless something, pit something, I can't remember, but it's somewhere in the middle of the album. There is this part where the guitar, it's a tiny guitar sound going, and then I sort of improvise on that, and then he sort of sync some of the beats that I'm doing, stuff like that. So that was me playing alone, and then he decided after where to put his guitar, you know. And the same concept I was used now for this thing I did a few years ago. But I think it will take him some time to finish, because I recorded four hours, and another like a speed metal drummer, Dirk from Belgium, I think. He was there and recorded also some, you know, like blast beats, I think. But then the funny thing is that Fredrik now, he plays more drums than guitar. He gets really passionate. He whenever he gets into something, the other stuff around disappears. So
right.
I think that the new Meshuggah album, for instance, he wasn't, it was just finished, you know, it's going to be released in a few months, I think. And he's not really involved this time at all, as for the composing and the direction of the music, because he's playing drums, you know, so he didn't have time to be involved. So he gets this, he bought some drums on eBay. Every drum on the kit is a bass drum. So he has I think it's a 28 kick drum, and then the first tom is 24, I think, and then there is 26 and 28 floor bass drums as floor toms. So everything is super huge, and he's trying to, you know, make some new directions with this drums as the foundation for something new, you know. And then I don't know if anything of what I recorded a few years ago will be on his coming album, or if he will play only by himself on this bass drum kit. I don't know.
That's fascinating. I saw Terry Bozzio a year ago, I think, and he's coming back. I'm seeing him in a couple weeks, and just to listen to 90 minutes of drum playing, at first it kind of sounds like it might be, what am I getting myself into? But it went by so fast, and I'm really looking forward to this next concert where he's presumably going to improvise another 90 minutes on this mega kit of his.
Fredrik, he has only one tom and two floor toms, but they are big, you know, so he can't.
Mm-hmm.
But we'll see. I'm sure it's going to be great. When he gets into it and he gets sorted out what to use and not, and it will be cool, very very good in the end. And he was here also. I recorded. Me and Matt recorded albums since '96, and we have like eight releases or something, nine releases. And but my first solo album was made last year. My
with an orchestra?
No, that's upcoming stuff.
Oh, okay.
Now I get accompanied by my wife here.
Hello.
Hello.
Oh,
don't let me disturb you. I'm just going to get some envelopes.
She needs envelopes. No worries. But the morchestra is something that will be, that's something I have been working on for the last 6 months for an upcoming orchestra project that, that me and Matt's going to do in October.
Wonderful.
And my solo album was... my
sorry.
Is she okay?
Yeah.
I'm just trying to get attention. Hello.
Hello. Goodbye. Have a nice day.
The same to you.
Thank you.
My solo album is Fredrik is on the solo album. Yeah, that was my what I was going to say. So he was here for a day, like 2 years ago, and we improvised together, drums and guitar.
This is on Battery Deluxe.
Yeah, Battery Deluxe. So it's actually a song called. Now I forgot, but it's one track on the album, and it's the same track as Devin Townsend is with me, you know, because we did the guitar, the bass and drums and guitar together, and then I put that together with another piece that I did together with Devin. So it's actually two pieces cut together, edit together as one piece. So Fredrik was here to do that, yeah, so but we'll see. It's hopefully he's gonna finish his album someday.
So I see on your website, obviously you're from Sweden, you're in Sweden. There are several quotes on your website about how if you were not in Sweden, you know, you'd be huge, or you're doing the wrong thing being in Sweden. I did an interview with Mattias Eklund as well, another Swedish musician. Can you tell me about the role of Sweden and the, what it means to you? Because obviously, you've had opportunities in the U.S. and in other places. But you return home, and
yeah, I think that you know, as soon as I started to play with Mats, which was many years even before I moved from my parents' house, you know, so I knew already by then that this is what I want to do. I want to play my own music with Mats, you know, we want to do our own thing, and not necessarily only that, because if Alan Holdsworth would call me back then, I would fly in a second, you know, but we created our own thing, and we wanted to make that grow and to do that, you know, and while doing your own thing, you can basically live in wherever, you know, except for where there is wars going on. I mean, Sweden is a good country. It's safe to live here still. My friends and family are here. And so US, for instance, felt like a good country to visit once a year or something for nice projects. But for a country to live in, I was never really into moving to US, I think. And the thing was that when we met Frank, we played with Frank in 88, and he invited me and Mats to come to play with him in the US after that. He invited us to play as guests in 88 at his concert in Sweden. And then before we, you know, after the concert, he gave me and Mats his address, and he told us that he wants a new drummer and a keyboard player. He needs a new drummer and keyboard player, and then he gave us his address, and then he went away in his limo, and there we were standing, and sort of, what's going to happen now, you know? And then 2 years went by, almost, like, 2 years, and then I wrote to him, and I tried to contact him without any success, and then one day I called Barking Pumpkin, his record company, and the guy who answered the phone, a guy named Gerald Fialka, he instantly knew who I was, which was a surprise for me, because this was, you know, before internet, and, you know, at least for me, I don't know when was the internet around, actually? What year?
1996, 98, yeah. People started getting access.
Yeah, so this was in 90, so I didn't know that he knew about us. So, but he said, you should come over. You can stay in my sofa and make sure to connect with Frank. So I went there, you know, and then I turned 2 days later, I ended up in Frank's house, and he was already getting ill from the cancer that he got. And but I mean, if the scenario would have been that he would have not been ill and starting up a new band and touring and stuff, of course we would have moved there if it would be like that, you know. Mm-hmm. But so for cool projects, and if we would end up being in his band or any other cool band, I wouldn't mind move. But just to move there and do what we're doing here, I'd never felt any reason for that, and that's why I stayed, I think. But I enjoyed it a lot to do stuff there, because we, for some years, we were there at least once a year doing projects with different things, you know. So it's nice. And actually, Frank said, oh, no, don't move to US, he said. That's what it's all. Stay in Sweden and come here for... he said something like that. Because he wasn't a big fan of US, generally speaking, I think. But I think for some reason he thought that me and Mats would be better off being here. I don't know why.
That story you wrote on your site about Scott Tunis fixing Mats's keyboard pedal, I was laughing so hard reading it.
I actually have I can give you another one.
Sure.
Equally good, which because this has also to do with Frank and how to learn music and some of the other things we spoke about. And it has to do with Scott Tunis again, because in 92 or 93, I can't remember now, we were invited again by Frank to come to the US to perform something that was called The Music of Frank Zappa, but it was the more orchestral stuff that he did. So it was a performance at the Lincoln Center at the Avery Fisher Hall. And full symphony orchestra, and then me, Matt, Scott Tunis, and Mike Keneally. That was the setup. And Matt's got a request to perform a world premiere of one of Frank's piano pieces called Ruth is Sleeping. And Matt got so excited, he called me and said, Frank asked me to do the premiere of an unheard piano piece, you know, and that was just like a dream, you know. And then some weeks later, he received a cassette tape, and the music was in original speed, and Ruth is Sleeping is the thing you call 12-tone music. It's a lot of notes, you know, and 12-tone music usually means that you never get to play the same note before all of the other notes is being played, and then you can play that note again. So it's the variation is if you play a C, you can't go back to C until all the other
11 notes are played.
Exactly. So, and there is super complicated to play, really. But he got really excited until he got this tape, you know. And Matsy called me and he said that, oh, this is incredibly hard, you know. But he started to work on it. He listened to with headphones, taking 3 seconds at a time. But then after a few weeks, he really felt that it's too fast, you know, because it's really fast. It's really hard to even hear the notes. And I mean, to play them is one thing, but even to hear them, you know. So then he asked for a music score, and a score was sent to Mats, and he took the score to a friend of him who is also a friend who is a classical concert pianist, and Carl Axel Dominic is his name, by the way. And he recorded the whole piece from the score, reading and playing maybe a little bit less than half tempo. Mm-hmm. So he can hear all the notes. And then he then he started to work on this, and that was much easier, you know. But when it was like 2-3 weeks before we were supposed to go to US, he was only like maybe 70% into the piece, so he was still missing the last stuff, you know. So he realized, I'm not gonna be able to memorize the last 2 minutes or something. And he had to call Frank about it, and knowing how strict Frank could be and how much of a perfectionist he could be, the answer he gave to Mats was unreal. Because, you know, imagine Mats, and this was 92, Mats is something, he's 20, maybe, mm-hmm. something.
Calling one of his musical idols. Long distance, international.
Hey, it's Matt. You know, I'm working on Ruthie Sleeping, but I'm only going to be able to memorize maybe 70%. And then Frank says, "So play that and then improvise," he said. Huh. And then he said, "But learn the last part, you know. So you play from the beginning up to 70%, then you play an improvised part, whatever. I mean, that's, he just gives that to Mats. You improvise, you know, and then wow. learn the last 30 seconds. Because there is the very last movement of this piano piece is very cool, and it's quite easy to hear the notes and stuff. So he spent another couple of days to memorize the ending, but then he left out that other section before the end, and it was so fantastic that Frank has the what do you say, I don't know the word, if Frank wouldn't say something like that to Mats unless he has belief in what he can do, you know.
Right, yeah, creative respect and freedom.
So yeah. That was fantastic. And now the funny thing about Scott was that just before going onto the stage on this premiere performance on Lincoln Center, I'm holding Mats on the side of the stage. I'm just about to leave him, to take him into the piano. And Scott has this idea that he whispers in Mats' ears, and he says, "Mats, I have an idea. In the middle of the piece, you stand up and you scream, 'Oh God, I'm blind!'" You know, that was just unreal. You know, he didn't do that though. But yeah, Scott, he had his moments when we rehearsed for the Zappa's Universe also. Which story did you hear? Was that with the piano, the pedal? Was that the one you mentioned?
Yes.
Yeah. There's many of them actually. Yeah, it was funny.
You're well. I'd love to hear your actual words, and you can share that with people if you're up for it.
It was during the rehearsal, and Mats had a Yamaha electric grand piano, and the pedal just folded off the hook, you know, and fall on the floor, and the conductor was just starting the band, but Scott was not with his bass, you know, so the conductor, you know, and the room is filled now with people in tuxedos and stuff, you know, proper people, age 60, 70, something like that, and the conductor, Joel Thome, says, "What is happening? Scott," is starting to look for Scott, and Scott is now under the piano with a piece of tape fixing the pedal to Matt's piano, and then he says, "What are you doing, Scott?" And then Scott screams with a loud voice from on all four, you know, on the piano, "I'm taping Matt's penis to his leg," you know, and the whole orchestra was like, you know, like that. Yeah, stuff like that. So he was really
what a character.
Yeah.
That's awesome. So I have one last question for you that I've been thinking of, and then I actually have to go to work.
Yeah.
A lot of the music that I love and that you've brought up, that you love, is older music. You know, music from the 70s and 80s. What do you hear today that is inspiring? And you know, if you were to start today and not have those records from the 70s, what would you be listening to?
Well, actually, I mean, at home in my kitchen when we are in the house, I listen to music that's as quiet as possible, because there's so much noise in the house. So it's nice to have some smooth Chet Baker type of stuff. That's perfect. In my house, I mean, in my studio, I can listen to anything, but in the house, I listen to quiet stuff. But I found like, for instance, a guy named a piano player called Nick Birch.
He's awesome.
ECM on the ECM label. He's done some really nice hypnotic, very like when things are repeating and repeating.
It's that minimalism.
Yeah, exactly.
Steve Reich and Philip Glass.
Yeah, exactly. Because I like that too, and so that's nice. And I like Norway has a couple of acts that I think is fresh, and you know, like when they mix typical jazz sounds with the computerized music and stuff. There is this band called Jaga Jazzist, which I like, and sometimes you just run into something. For instance, you interviewed Ben Levin recently, mm-hmm. and I ran into one of their songs called "Being Human." And there is this part somewhere towards the end where she's really singing those incredible notes, I think it's just, I can hear that this music comes, I can hear from where this music comes, but still it's a little bit new and fresh, and I think that was nice to hear. And what else? You know, I have been enjoying also Electronica by Square Pusher, you know, stuff like that. He was actually here just a couple of months ago in my studio, because we are planning, we have some ideas that we will hopefully make together in the future.
Oh, that's great. He is what a player and what a creative musician.
Yeah, I think. And so I like some of that type of music as well. So usually when I mention all these bands from the 70s is because they are my roots, you know, that's where it started for me, and therefore it's hard to match that with something else, because the impact that it had on me being 10, 12, 14 and discovering these albums is really hard to get that kick now being, you know, 40, 50, you know, it's really, I went to see a concert a couple of years ago with a band called Deerhoof.
Oh, they're awesome. Yeah. Yes, Deerhoof.
And I saw them live in a tiny, sweaty little place in Stockholm, and some moments were just totally fantastic. I think I especially like the parts that sounds like it sounds like Captain Beefheart, but with a punk, more violent way. And I think it sounded really cool. And I have their albums. There is a few songs on this album called "Offend Maggie," which I think is fantastic. You know, I like when a group or an artist have something that. There could be, it doesn't have to be a whole album, but suddenly there is this 10 seconds thing that knocks you out totally, and then you have to repeat that on and on and on and on and on, because it's, I think there is a few parts on Offend Maggie album by Deerhoof like that, and that's kind of cool, you know. And But as for new acts, there could be more. I'm sure there. I can't just remember them now, but there is, I'm sure.
Cool. Well, thank you for your perspective. I really, really appreciate all the time you've given me, and thank you so much for being up for doing this and checking your hidden Facebook message folder.
Yeah. Well, my pleasure.
Thank you, Morgan.
Thank you.